So talk to us, Brett, about the dynamics at play with the spot trading here. And does this just undermine the merge overall?
So with proof of work, in order to be able to support the computational puzzle solving, in order to receive the mining rewards from the network, you have to create these giant rigs of servers that are going to solve these computationally hard problems, expend lots of energy to do so. They're very expensive. So all of these companies that put enormous amounts of money and investment into creating these mining rigs suddenly find themselves as useless in the new proof of stake post-merge world for Ethereum. So there's been a consortium of these miners that have banded together to basically create an entire fork, a copy of the Ethereum mainnet, to create their own proof of work, kind of classic version of Ethereum, and try to keep that going. Now, I agree with you that it sort of undermines the whole purpose here, which is that Ethereum moving to proof of stake means that this entire network, which is the most popular network for smart contract-based computation, is transitioning completely to an energy-efficient world and hopefully into a much faster transaction speed and lower transaction costs in the future. And this new ETH POW token isn't going to have the same property. However, the operators of this network were airdropping these tokens on existing Ethereum, existing Ethereum holders, and they're going to want to be able to claim those Ethereum tokens, the Ethereum W tokens, and trade out of them. And so we wanted to make sure that we allowed that as an exchange operator. Now, we aren't supporting deposits and withdrawals in them. We have many concerns over, actors trying to kind of put themselves in the middle of unsuspecting consumers, not being completely sure which Ethereum chain they're interacting with. And as a result, basically helping kind of steal money from people who don't really know what's going on. And that's really not good. We are full supporters of this move to proof of stake. We have also supported other crypto networks that have always supported proof of stake, like mm-hmm. Solana. And we think that's really is what the future of crypto is going
to
hold.
But to the point that you were making earlier, on one hand, there's a concern about any potential scamming here, people moving to the wrong areas. But also, while the actual technological change worked well today, how much does something like that undermine any credibility in a system?
The majority of the computational effort with regards to this Ethereum chain is happening now on the mainnet. And a very small amount of power and transactions are happening on this new ETH proof of work chain. Or, even though some mining activity has moved to Ethereum Classic and some other kind of EVM proof of work chains that still exist, everything is happening really on Ethereum. And so what we probably expect over time is for the activity on these to fizzle out. Vitalik himself has said that he expects and hopes that this will happen. And people will, basically give up the old way of proof of work, transition completely to proof of stake, because this is, a superior system in a lot of ways. And obviously there's always trade-offs, security, reliability, speed, the kind of investment you need to get into the network in the first place, level of decentralization. And that's still open for debate between proof of work and proof of stake systems. It brings interesting questions into play with regards to Bitcoin and what its future is going to be. But we and the Ethereum community as a whole really do support this new proof of stake post-merge world. And we expect 100% of the activity to move there over time.
What's your response to SEC Chair Gary Gensler's comments on the merge in particular? I mean, he's been pretty clear, doesn't think Bitcoin falls under securities regulation, but that post-merge, the Ethereum network could.
So there are many complicated legal analyses involved in trying to decipher, which aspects of the system might be securities and which might not. So, for example, the CFTC already regulates Ethereum, Ether futures on multiple venues, including CME, ICE, FTX US derivatives, and it basically lays claim to that being a commodity. But perhaps the staking in such a system might be considered an investment contract of some kind, and that's really an open question. And there are multiple kinds of staking as well. There's you directly participating in the network as a validator. There's you delegating your tokens to a validator to get the rewards from staking. There's also investment staking, which is sort of none of the above, where you, delegate your tokens to some sort of protocol, a DeFi protocol, which promises certain yield. All of these have, different characteristics that, may or may not pass the four prongs of the Howey test. And it's all an open question. And aside from the regulatory risks, there's also other risks involved in staking. You know, for example, the price action that can occur between now and when Ethereum actually unlocks, and the fact that Ethereum staked Ethereum won't unlock for people to reap those rewards for probably 6 to 12 months still. And there's operational risk involved too. If a validator fails to properly validate a block, it could have some of its stake tokens taken away. And so there's a number of risks that are still involved in the aspect of staking.
So with those risks, plus that regulatory overhang, to what extent is that a problem when you have a new model that is contingent on staking? From what I understand, FTX doesn't really offer this as a business yet. Coinbase is making it a much bigger part of their business, but there are still these big open questions about it.
The staking and proof of stake networks are a huge part of the crypto ecosystem. And while it's extremely significant that Ethereum has finally moved to proof of stake, it's certainly not the first. And in fact, most other popular blockchains, you know, other than Bitcoin, are already on a proof of stake system. They already have this validator set up where by staking a certain amount of the token in the network, you are guaranteed some amount of the fees from the transaction and, you know, block validation rewards. And so we're sort of already very long this problem as an industry. What we hope to see is, you know, regulatory clarity and continued productive discussions with the SEC. They've been very open discussing with us and many other industry players about the possibility of offering some of these services in the future or even presently. And hopefully with, you know, a lot of movement in Congress, you know, whether it's the DCCPA or, you know, other bills that are floating around right now, that we'll start to get better clarity over different crypto products, whether they're considered securities or not, whether there are clear paths to registration for different kinds of either crypto lending or crypto staking activities, and that we'll be able to, you know, properly register these kinds of investment vehicles if they are ones, or make sure that they're not and that they can be considered, you know, non-securities and therefore offered by exchanges such as ourselves easily.